devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayamudirayet Nashtaprayeshva Badreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavatir Uttamashloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya cha Nandagopakumaraya Govindaya Namo Namaha. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 18, entitled Description of Varnashram Dharma, Text Number 37. Nahi tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Tatas sampadyate maya Nahi tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Tatas sampadyate maya Nahi tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Tatas sampadyate maya Nahi tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Tatas sampadyate maya Nahi tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Tatas sampadyate maya Tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Padyate maya
Matajis
Nahi tasya vikalpakya Yacha madvikshayahata Adehantat kvachit kyatis Tatas sampadyate maya.
Word to word translation. Na, not, he, certainly, tasya, for the realized person, vikalpa, of something separate from Krishna, akhya, perception, ya, which perception, cha, also, mat, of me, vikshaya, by realized knowledge, hata, is destroyed, ah, until, deha, of the body, antat, the death, kvachit, sometimes, kyatihi, such perception, tata, then, sampadyate, achieves equal opulences, maya, with me. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: a realized soul no longer sees anything as separate from me. For his realized knowledge of me has destroyed such illusory perception. Since the material body and mind were previously accustomed to this kind of perception, it may sometimes appear to recur. But at the time of death, the self-realized soul achieves opulences equal to mine. Purport: Lord Krishna explained in verse 32 of this chapter that all material and spiritual objects are expansions of His potency. By realized knowledge of the Lord, one gives up the illusion that anything, anywhere, at any time can be separate from Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna has also explained, however, that one must keep the material body and mind fit for executing devotional service. Therefore, even a self-realized soul may sometimes appear to accept or reject certain conditions or objects within this world. Such brief apparent duality of concentration upon something other than Krishna does not change the liberated status of a self-realized soul who achieves at the time of death the same opulences as Lord Krishna in the spiritual world. The function of illusion is to separate one from Lord Krishna. But the brief and occasional appearance of duality in the behavior or mentality of a pure devotee never separates him from the Lord. It does not constitute actual illusion, for it lacks the essential function of illusion, namely the separation of one from Lord Krishna. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur describes the self-realized devotees as follows. The devotee of the Lord does not see anything as separate from Lord Krishna and thus does not consider himself to be a permanent resident of the material world. At every moment, the devotee is moved by his desire to serve Lord Krishna. Just as those who are inclined to sense gratification pass their time making arrangements for their enjoyment, similarly the devotees are busy throughout the day arranging their devotional service to Lord Krishna. Therefore, they have no time to act like a materialistic sense enjoyers. To ordinary persons, it may seem that a pure devotee is seeing something as separate from Krishna. But a pure devotee is actually fixed in his status as a liberated soul and is guaranteed to achieve a spiritual body in the kingdom of God. Ordinary materialistic persons cannot always understand the activities of a pure devotee of the Lord, and thus they may try to minimize his position, consider him to be the same as themselves. At the end of life, however, the results achieved by the devotees of the Lord and ordinary materialists are vastly different. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena
Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Mano Bishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Sva Padantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raguna Tanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamsya He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrinda Vaneshwari Rishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare We are discussing the 11th canto, 18th chapter, the description of the Varnashram Dharma. So Krishna explained the the qualities and the occupations of the different Varnas, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. And then he explained the the duties of the people in the different ashramas. Brahmachari, Grihastha, Vanaprastha and Sannyasi. Now in this last section of this chapter, Krishna explains the topmost stage in the Varnashram system, or the topmost stage in the the order of Sannyas, that he is describing about the Paramahamsas in these verses. In today's verse, it's explained that the stage of a Paramahamsa, a person sees everything in relation to Krishna. Because whatever we see in this world, it is a energy of Krishna. The living entities are the superior energy of Krishna, and the material, the matter is the external energy or the inferior energy of Krishna. So a Paramahamsa sees everything in connection with Krishna. But this verse says, but sometimes a Paramahamsa, he might be selective about certain material conditions. He might be selective about certain things which may be favorable to keep his body and mind fit. Because Krishna also mentions that one should keep one's body and mind fit in order to discharge devotional service. So therefore, Paramahamsa, sometimes he may be selective about certain material conditions. In that sense, he has a perception of the duality. Okay, this food is favorable or this food is not favorable. Traveling by this mode is favorable or like something like that. Or a Paramahamsa, in the sense, he may choose a particular material situation over the another
because he finds that he can better render service Krishna in the particular material situation. But this apparent perception of the duality does not diminish his liberated status. And he ultimately attains the he attains the spiritual world. That's what this verse says. So, like for example, suppose we switch off the fan, but it takes some time for the fan to actually come to stand still. So similarly, the Paramahamsa, although in one sense he is liberated, he sees everything in connection with Krishna, but because he is still operating in this material world, he is still using his material body, which is composed of matter, but because he is using the material body in the service of Krishna, in the sense that it is spiritualized, but still it is composed of matter. So in order to keep the body in a fit condition, he may choose a particular situation which is favorable for keeping the body fit. In that sense, there is a perception of duality, but that does not diminish his liberated status. When the fan is switched off, the fan may be still, the momentum is seen, but actually the power is cut off. It's just a matter of time that it comes to a standstill. So the Paramahamsa ultimately attained the abode of the Supreme Lord. Maya sampad, tata sampadyate maya. That means he will achieve actually opulences equal to mine. So essentially, if we see the Paramahamsa sannyasi, Paramahamsa sannyasi is in one sense, he is beyond the varnashram status. So the varnashram system is like the booster racket. I think few days back Vasudev Prabhu was giving this example. Like booster racket is actually, it takes the satellite out of the gravitational pull and then it puts the satellite into the orbit. Once the satellite is put into the orbit, once the satellite goes out of the gravitational pull, then there is no need of a booster racket. So similarly, the varnashram, it takes a person beyond the material platform, and when a person comes to the transcendental platform, then varnashram is not required. Just like when the satellite comes into the orbit, then the booster racket is no longer required. Or, of course, we can also say that there is varnashram even in the spiritual world. But in the spiritual world, varnashram is there for the sake of rasa, for the sake of enhancing Krishna's pastimes. But in the material world, varnashram is there in order to keep peace and orderliness in the society. So therefore, the Paramahamsa Sannyasi, who is in a liberated platform, he is actually, like sometimes he may break the varnashram rules, or he may appear to behave like a madman. But because he has completely transcended the material illusion. But of course, this verse, the present verse we are reading is that, but sometimes a person may, because of the previous habit, he might choose a favorable material situation, but that doesn't diminish his liberated position. That's what Krishna is saying in this verse. So, there are two types of Paramahamsas. One type of Paramahamsa is that, although they have gone beyond the varnashram system, but still they act within the varnashram system. For example, Krishna says in the Gita, karma naivahi samsiddhim asthito janakadaya loka sangraham evapi sampashyan kartum argasi. Krishna says that there are kings like Janak Maharaj, he is already liberated, he is a self-realized soul, but still Janak Maharaj, he performed prescribed duties just for the sake of educating the people in general. So similarly, you should also perform your prescribed duty of fighting. So kings like Janak Maharaj, although they are liberated, But still they act within the Varnashram system in order to actually teach the people. Or another example Prabhupada gives of Prithu Maharaj. Karmanicha yata kalam, yata desham yata balam, yato chitta yato vittam, akarod brahma sadkritam. Although Prithu Maharaj was self-satisfied, he executed his duties as perfectly as possible according to the time and situation. But in all his activities, his aim was to satisfy the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That purport Prabhupada says that Prithu Maharaj was actually in a Paramahamsa, he was a Paramahamsa Vaishnava, but still, he did not allow himself to act outside the Varnashram system. He remained at his position as a Kshatriya to rule the world, and at the same time, he remained transcendental to such activities by satisfying the Supreme Lord. So Prabhupada explains that indeed whatever he did as an emperor was perfectly befitting a pure devotee. And there is a pure devotee's activities may appear like ordinary activities, but behind them there is profound significance. What is that? That is the satisfaction of the Lord. So therefore, one kind of Paramahamsa is that although in one sense he is beyond the Varnashram system, but he acts within the Varnashram system because he is living in the society. So therefore, he performs the different responsibilities of the Varnashram to satisfy the Supreme Lord. That's why Prabhupada explains in that purport that devotees in the Krishna consciousness movement should set examples for people for how to practice bhakti yoga and karma yoga. Because detailing the Varnashram duties as a satisfaction of the Supreme Lord, that comes under the category of karma yoga. So devotees should set example for the common people how to do both. And there is another kind of Paramahamsa who is also beyond the Varnashram. But he doesn't externally, he doesn't practice the different responsibilities of Varnashram. He is completely transcending. he behaves like a avadut kind of, he behaves like a madman. And we'll discuss this in more detail. And then there is a third kind of person who appears like a Paramahamsa, who appears like a sannyasi, but within his mind, he actually meditates on sense gratification. Karmendriyani samyamya ya aste manasa smaran indriyartan vimudatma mityachara sa uchyate. That Krishna says that that somebody who adopts the renounced order, but if he meditates on sense gratification, he is a mityachara, he is a pretender. On the other hand, a honest grahasa is superior, like that Krishna explains in the third chapter. So today, I'll mainly discuss about this a Paramahamsa, because this section is about the Paramahamsa sannyasis, that we discussed about Janak Maharaj and Prithu Maharaj, and I want to discuss about the Paramahamsa devotee who doesn't externally practice any of the rules of the Varnashram. So we'll discuss this from the character of Jadabharat from the fifth canto. I'll try to highlight some points from the life of Jadabharat and Bharat Maharaj, this relation. So this is a very prominent section in the fifth canto. Jadabharat, as you know that he was Bharat Maharaj. He was the son of Rishabhadev, the eldest son of Rishabhadev. Before Bharat Maharaj, the land was known as Ajanabha Varsha. Because Rishabhadev was ruling this world, and Rishabhadev was the son of King Nabi. And so, because he ruled so nicely, that world was called as Ajanabha Varsha. But after Rishabhadev, when Bharat Maharaj started ruling, then the this became the word Bhumandala came to be known as actually Bharatvarsha. In fact, the part of the Bhumandala in the Jambudvipa, the Bharatvarsha, it was known as Bharatvarsha. It was named after Bharat Maharaj. So Bharat Maharaj, as an emperor after ruling, then when he actually renounced his kingdom, he went to the banks of the Gandaki River and he performed started performing intense devotional service. But he got attached to a deer, and then he left his body thinking of the deer, and therefore in the next life he became a deer. But he had the remembrance of the Supreme Lord as a deer, so therefore he felt a great remorse for actually misusing that opportunity. And then in the next life, he actually was born as Jadabharat. So Jadabharat was actually born in a family of the Brahmanas who come in the dynasty of Angira Rishi. So Jadabharat's father, the qualities of Jadabharat's father are described. So Jadabharat's father had great mind and sense control. He was austere, he had studied the Vedas. He was renounced and he was satisfied. He was tolerant. He had humility. He had a lack of envy. He had great knowledge. And this Jadabharat's father, he had two wives. Through the first wife, he had 9 sons. And through the second wife, he got twins. And one of the twins, there was one boy and one girl. And that boy was actually Jadabharat, who was Bharat Maharaj in the previous life. So Jadabharat, it's explained that although he was born in a very high class Brahmana family, you can just see the different qualities of his father. He was not an ordinary person, he was a very highly qualified Brahmana. But despite that, Jadabharat, because he had remembrance of his past life and he didn't want to take up another birth, so therefore he was always conscious of, he was intensely conscious of Krishna within his heart. But externally, he would behave like a madman. So, and also, another reason why he behaved like that was that, although he was born in a family of the Brahmanas, but his family members were, they were inclined towards the karmakanda brahminical activities. They were not interested in pure devotional service. And therefore, Jadabharat, he didn't want to get affected by their association. Although they are not some people in the mode of ignorance or something, but they were brahminical people, but they were more inclined towards the karmakanda rituals. But Jadabharat, because he was such a Paramahamsa devotee, that he didn't want to get affected by their association. So Prabhupada gives an important lesson about the one of the principles of sadhana bhakti is that avoiding the association of non-devotees. Of course, we have to remember that our mind itself is a non-devotee. Or we have to, many times our mind acts like a non-devotee. And of course, this principle has to be followed carefully. Like when we are living in this world, we may be living in a particular community, we may be living in a particular, say, family, working in a particular company. So on a practical level, we have to deal with different people. But we shouldn't get emotionally involved in associating with the non-devotees, because that will actually pull us in a different direction. So therefore, Jadabharat is any principle which is described in the Shastra, it is highlighted in the Srimad Bhagavatam in a very great degree, in the highest degree, that we cannot imitate the way Jadabharat actually behaved, but this principle has to be learnt and then we have to apply it in our life, according to our situation. So Jadabharat, fearing the association of his family members, he always remembered the lotus feet of the Lord, which destroy the bondage of karma by hearing and remembering about his qualities. So Jada Bharat was conscious of Krishna internally, and at the same time he was cautious of Maya. So one has to understand the power of Krishna, and one has to understand the power of Maya in order to become serious in Krishna consciousness. Daivi hesha gunamayi mama maya duratyaya mamevaye prapadyante maya metam tarantiti. How the Maya is powerful, at the same time how Krishna is also powerful. Like Shaubari Muni, he was performing austerities within the water. He was in one sense cautious of Maya. He isolated himself from all the material surroundings. But he was not properly conscious of Krishna. Because when a person is Krishna conscious, then one is also conscious of the position of Krishna's devotees, one respects them properly. But Shaubari Muni, because he was not properly conscious of Krishna, therefore he actually offended Krishna's devotee Garuda. So therefore he fell from his exalted position, because he was only conscious of Maya but not conscious of Krishna. But Bharat Maharaj, he was conscious of Krishna, in fact, we'll discuss that verse maybe later. But that is why he, although he was such a great emperor, but he renounced his opulence and he went to perform devotional service with one-pointed attention in the forest. But he was not so cautious of Maya, so that is why he got attached to the deer and then he fell from his exalted position. He became the deer in the next life. So therefore, one has to be conscious of Krishna and cautious of Maya. And Jada Bharat, whenever his father would actually try to teach Jada Bharat in the different Brahminical activities, he would try to teach Jada Bharat like how to perform achaman, how to perform cleanliness, how to cleanse oneself after passing stool, and how to chant the Gayatri mantra. But Jada Bharat would actually perform exactly the opposite activities. Whatever his father would teach, he would actually, first he would cleanse himself and then he would go to pastul. So like that, he would perform exactly in opposite way, in such a way that people lose all their inspiration to guide him and educate him. Because he felt that if I seem like obedient to them, then they will have more inspiration to teach me more. So he behaved in a very opposite way. So there is a verse, Krishna says that Budho balakavat kreedet kushalo jadavat charet vaded unmattavat vidvan gocharyam naigamas charet. A Paramahamsa sannyasi, although he is highly intelligent, but he behaves like a small child. And although he is expert, but he behaves like a stone or a inert person. And although he can speak eloquently, but he speaks like a foolish man, or he doesn't speak only. Vadetu, he speaks like a madman. And gocharyam naigamas charit. And he doesn't follow the different rules and regulations. So Jada Bharat was behaving like that. And generally in the material world, in the Kali Yuga, people, like, we find that, say in the film industry or celebrities, like, although one may be getting old, somebody may be actually 50 years old or beyond that, but with all different kinds of facelifts and plastic surgery, and this one, they want to appear young. And the Kali Yuga, the whole sound vibration is about, although one may not have the certain, say, qualities, either in terms of the beauty or in terms of knowledge, etc., but one wants to pose as if like he's actually expert in that field. So that is the nature of actually Kali Yuga. Generally, in any field, like for example, previously, whether it's the field of music or study of the Shastra, one would actually study for many years under a teacher, and then he would actually try to expose himself to the outside world, try to teach and share that with others. So after investing for a long time, then a person actually shares with the outside world. But in the modern world, is that a person is putting more effort to actually to pose as in order to reach out to the outside world before actually investing enough before performing enough sadhana, study of the Shastra or in any field, before actually putting so much of effort of sadhana, one wants to actually present oneself to the outside world. So that is like for example, suppose somebody is dressing himself. A person puts a, say, shirt and coat and tie. And after putting everything, then he realizes, oh, I have not put the tilak. And then somehow he tries to put tilak in the, because we can put tilak in the forehead, but somehow he tries to put tilak in the, within the body. So the normal course is first you put tilak in the body and then you put actually the, you put the different clothes. So similarly, normally first one should get the proper training, one should perform the proper sadhana, then a person should reach out. But some of the modern psychology is that they want to reach out first before investing enough sadhana on oneself. But Jada Bharat, although he was so exalted, but he behaved like this madman. And Jada Bharat's brothers, all his brothers were actually highly learned in the Shastra. They were highly learned in the Rig Veda, Yajur Veda and Sama Veda. But they could not appreciate Jada Bharat's exalted position. So his father died at a certain point. And Jada Bharat's mother, feeling separation from her husband, she actually entered Sati. And then Jada Bharat was actually being taken care of by his by the elder brothers. And these brothers, they would actually engage Jada Bharat in different menial activities. And they could not actually appreciate his exalted position. Because Jada Bharat was a person who was having a highly refined spiritual emotions, but he didn't exhibit that externally. But his brothers were more in a, although they were learned in the Vedas, but they were in a more material platform, they were in a grass platform. So therefore they couldn't appreciate his exalted position. Like later we find when Jada Bharat was actually forced to carry the palanquin, at that time, because he was a person having a highly refined spiritual emotions, he didn't want to step on an ant when he was carrying the palanquin. But the other three people who are carrying the palanquin of Rahugan Maharaj, and they were more on a very grass platform, and they would go very fast, and suddenly when Jada Bharat would stop, the palanquin would get a jerk, and then the king would become angry. So somebody who is at a kriyatmaka level or who is on a grass level, he cannot appreciate the refined spiritual emotions of an exalted person. Therefore, Jada Bharat's brothers actually mistreated him, and they would actually engage him in actually guarding the field, and they would simply throw some dry oil cakes for eating. And Jada Bharat, he would not raise any complaint. He would just accept the whatever is given. He would just try to eat it. So therefore, those who are in the absorbed in the karmakanda level, they cannot appreciate the exalted position of a devotee. Even in the 10th canto, there is an example which comes that when the cowherd boys went and asked for some footsteps from the brahmanas who were performing the karmakanda yajna, But these Brahmanas, because they were absorbed in their petty desires for going to heaven, because they were absorbed in their Karmakanda Yajna, although they heard the words of the cowherd boys, but still they did not hear. Shrinvanto api na sushruhu. So although they heard, but still they did not hear, because their absorption was in that aim of going to heaven, therefore they were absorbed in Karmakanda. So the personality of Jadabharat, he actually exemplifies in one sense the actual message of the Srimad Bhagavatam. The position of the Srimad Bhagavatam is described in the very beginning, where Shukdev Vyasdev writes that Vedyam Vastavam Atra Vastu Shivadam Tapatrayon Mulanam. Vedyam Vastava Vastu. So Srimad Bhagavatam describes about the real substantial essence. It is talking about the real substance, the substance of devotion to Krishna, the substance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and devotional service to Krishna. And Jadabharat, because he was so much focused on the essence, and therefore he behaved like that. So therefore, from Jadabharat, we can actually understand how a person should try to learn on the essence. Nanu Dveshti Kalim Samrat Sarango Iva Sarabuk. Parishit Maharaj, because he was focused on the essence, he could find a good quality in Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga is an age where there is an ocean of faults. Kaler Dosha Nide Rajan. But in the ocean of faults, but Parishit Maharaj could find a good quality. So that is what it means to be a Saragrahi, to be focused on the essence. So Jadabharat was a person who was focused on the essence, therefore he actually behaved like that. So like one shouldn't, so we can also see that like one cannot judge a devotee only based on the externals. Yeah, there is a room for discrimination that is also there. But we cannot judge only based on the externals. Like suppose a tailor who was was using a big scissor for cutting a cloth. And then after cutting the cloth, like he had kept a small needle in the in his topi, and then he used that needle to stitch the cloth. And then the child asked that, why are you keeping the small needle here and you are keeping the big scissor in the floor? The tailor said that, do not try to judge the utility of something just based on the size of something. The big scissor can only cut the cloth, but it cannot actually stitch the cloth. Although the small needle is, it may be small, but it can actually stitch the cloth. So therefore, we cannot judge any substance or a person based on the external. One has to focus on the deeper utility of something. So Jadabharat, because his brothers were more into Karmakanda, so therefore, like, he didn't associate with them intimately. But whereas the same personality, Jadabharat, previously as Bharat Maharaj, he actually performed different Karmakanda yajnas. At that time, Bharat Maharaj, he was also a pure devotee at that time. But because he was playing the role of a king, he had to actually show to the people that if they want to actually fulfill their material desires, what is the dharmic way of fulfilling the material desires by following the Vedic Karmakanda path. So externally he was performing the different Karmakanda yajna, but internally when the Brahmanas would say Indraya Swaha, he would be thinking that, oh, this is an offering to the hand of my Supreme Lord. Because the different devatas are the limbs of Supreme Personality of Godhead. When they would say Agnaye Swaha, he would think that, oh, this is an offering to the mouth of my Supreme Lord. So as Bharat Maharaj, he was performing the Karmakanda Yajna, because he was also playing the role of a king. But as Jadabharat, he didn't have any obligation to set example for others. to perform the karma kanda or something. So therefore, he actually behaved like a very madman externally. Baldev Vidyabhushan, in his Bhagavad Gita purport, he talks about three types of devotees. One is a Sanishta Bhakta. Sanishta Bhakta is a person who makes a gradual progress. He talks about a Sanishta Bhakta, he performs the, how he advances is that, he is mainly focused on performing the Varnashram duties, but he performs them as a service to Krishna. He may not be performing the nine processes of bhakti, but he performs the Varnashram duties as a service to Krishna. And from that stage, he advances to the stage of Jnana Yoga, and then he advances to the stage of Dhyana Yoga or Ashtanga Yoga. And then when he gets the association of a devotee, then he advances to the stage of Bhakti Yoga. A Sanishta Bhakta gradually progresses. Say from Karma Kanda, Sakama Karma Yoga, Nishkama Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. And then there is another type of devotee who is a Parinishtita Bhakta, who worships Krishna mainly by the nine processes of Bhakti, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, etc. But he performs the Varnashram duties in order to set example for the common people. Because he is living within this world. And then the third kind of devotee is the Nirapeksha Bhakta. Nirapeksha Bhakta, he doesn't perform any of the Varnashram duties. He is 24 hours engaged in the service of Krishna. He is 24 hours engaged in the different activities of bhakti. So Bharat Maharaj, he actually exemplifies the Parinishtita Bhakta. He was also a pure devotee, but then he was also performing the responsibilities of a king. Whereas Jada Bharat actually exemplifies the Nirapeksha Bhakta. For example, Krishna says that Yat Karoshi Yadashnasi Yajjihoshi Dadasi Yat Yat Tapasyasi Kaunteya Tat Kurushva Madarpanam. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever charity you may give it to others, whatever tapasya you perform, do it everything as an offering to me. So this is the verse which describes the Parinishtita Bhakta. Whereas the verses like Satatam Kirtayanto Mam Yadantascha Dridavrataha, constantly engaged in glorifying Krishna, that describes the Nirapeksha Bhakta. Or a Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Vraja. This also describes a Nirapeksha Bhakta, where a person rejects even the dharmic principles and surrenders to Krishna. So Jada Bharat, because he didn't follow even the many of the dharmic principles for a brahmachari or a brahmana, so he exemplifies a Nirapeksha Bhakta. So Bharat Maharaj, it's explained that when Bharat Maharaj went to the forest, he would be worshipping the Shaligram Shila. And when he was worshipping the Shaligram Shila, like his heart melted so much in ecstasy by seeing the form of the Lord, by serving the Lord, that he started exhibiting all the ecstatic symptoms. His hair stood on end, and then tears started actually flowing from his eyes. And his intelligence was immersed in the lake of his heart, filled with the highest bliss. And he couldn't perform any of his daily duties because he couldn't function only because his all the different ecstatic symptoms started erupting from his body. But then Bharat Maharaj, with a vow to worship the Lord, he actually suppressed his ecstasy. And he felt that, oh, these ecstatic symptoms are an obstacle for worshipping the Lord. And then, with his intelligence, he actually suppressed the ecstatic symptoms. He felt that, oh, my intelligence should not be covered by the ecstasy, and he suppressed that ecstasy, and then he started again worshipping the Lord. So this is, we can see, Bharat Maharaj, like he suppressed his spiritual ecstasies with his intelligence in order to continue to worship the Supreme Lord. The Nectar of Devotion, Rupa Goswami explains that when he describes about the mood of the different servants of Krishna, he says that being completely involved in serving according to one's capacity, friendship with the Lord's servants with absence of even a trace of envy on seeing the excellence of other service, and being fixed in their love, they are all considered to be the special anubhavas or ecstasies of the servants of Krishna. So one of the anubhava, one of the ecstasy is that being completely involved in serving according to one's capacity. And as an example, he gives the example of Dharuka. And Dharuka, once he was fanning Krishna, and then he started getting those ecstatic symptoms, and then he started cursing those ecstatic symptoms because he felt that that ecstatic symptoms are an obstacle for his service to Krishna. So Bharat Maharaj, he suppressed his ecstatic symptoms with his intelligence. So generally, when there is an intense suffering or intense happiness, many times one gets carried away from the purpose. Like Chitraketu Maharaj, when he got the sun after a very long time, he was so much overwhelmed with that happiness that he failed to give proper attention to all the queens. He paid all the attention to only one queen, who was the mother of Harshashoka. So therefore, the Vedic scriptures, they always talk about the balance between the buddhi and bhavana. There should be a samanvaya between the intelligence and the feelings. So sometimes a person can get carried away by the different feelings and one may forget his intelligence and one may make a wrong decision. So generally, it is described that Prabhupada's godbrother, O.B.L. Kapoor, he writes in his book that among the different philosophers in India, when they see about Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they don't see Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as a philosopher. Because Lord Chaitanya himself wrote only 8 shlokas. And when we read his biography, we only see pastimes of Lord Chaitanya dancing and chanting in South India. Like he only danced and chanted, gave the holy name to common people. And in his last pastimes in Antya Leela, like he exhibited such intense ecstatic symptoms. So they consider Lord Chaitanya as a devotee or as a saint. Some revolutionary, he also made Haridas Thakur as a Namacharya. But they don't consider Lord Chaitanya as a philosopher because they feel, what is this philosophical contribution? Just 8 shlokas. But actually, he says that the intentionally devotional character of the personality of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that has actually eclipsed his philosophical side. His place has been among the devotees and the mystics rather than among the philosophers. But the devotional side of his personality suggests a corresponding philosophical side of his nature, which is a definite and perfect sense of reality. His devotional side, his devotional emotions, they are the result of his correct perception of reality. Because he was so philosophically rooted, and the result of his correct perception of reality, that resulted in his devotional side. But the devotional side has completely eclipsed his philosophical side, that people consider him mainly as a devotee or as a saint, but not as a philosopher. So he says that on the contrary, Mahaprabhu's understanding is so developed and purified that his grasp of things is more intuitive than ratiocinative, and his knowledge of reality is more intimate and complete. Because Bhaktivinoda Thakur writes in his Dashamula Tattva, there are different philosophies given by the four Vaishnava Acharyas, Ramanuja, Madhvacharya, Nimbarka and Vishnu Swami. Shuddha Dvaita, Vishishta Dvaita, etc. But these philosophies, they don't satisfy all the statements of the Vedic literatures. And then he shows that how only the philosophy of Achintya Beda Beda, it perfectly satisfies all the statements of the Upanishads and the Vedas. And that Achintya Beda Beda is a contribution of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So therefore, Mahaprabhu had a accurate, clear sense of reality, but which resulted in that devotional emotions. But the devotional emotions eclipses philosophical side, and people consider him as they don't consider him as a philosopher. So therefore, one of the contribution of the, one of the unique speciality of the Sanatana Dharma is that there is a samanvaya between the buddhi and bhavana, feelings and the intelligence. Buddha bhava samanvita, which Krishna says in the 10th chapter. So here, coming back to Bharat Maharaj, when he was overcome by the spiritual emotions, he suppressed his spiritual emotions with his intelligence. And then he continued the worship of the Supreme Lord. But later, the same Bharat Maharaj fell victim to the material emotions of compassion. Like he passed a much higher test of not coming under the influence of the spiritual, not coming under the influence of spiritual emotions, spiritual ecstasies. But later, when he actually saved the deer and then he got attached to the deer and then he got carried away by the material emotions. So therefore, like suppose sometimes a person, somebody may come from, say, Calcutta to Bombay by flight. And he comes in, say, 2 hours to Bombay. But then from airport to house, he gets stuck in the traffic jam. And sometimes it may take more time than actually the time it took for him to come from Calcutta to Bombay. So he actually overcome the test of spiritual emotions, but he actually, Bharat Maharaj, succumbed to the material emotions. So Bharat Maharaj, because he was absorbed in serving the deer, and he forgot all his actually sadhana and the purpose for which he came to the forest. So Srila Prabhupada writes in his purports about the, he warns about the mundane philanthropy. So philanthropy, when we make the mundane philanthropy as the goal, it is like pouring water in a leaky bucket. How much ever you keep pouring water, it will never get filled. It is going to be an endless effort. Making mundane philanthropy as the goal, it is like entering into a tunnel which has no end. And one will get bewildered, and because you don't see the end of the tunnel. Because in the same way, how much ever you may do the philanthropy or the altruistic activities, you may feel that, oh, there is no end to it. And then one will become frustrated. Or mundane philanthropy is like blowing on a boil. When there is a boil in the body, when you blow on that boil, a person may feel good, but then you don't actually provide a lasting solution for the person. So therefore, when we talk about mundane philanthropy, they can be detailed in the service of Krishna. It's not that philanthropy is altogether bad, because Krishna himself says that yatkaroshi yadashnasi yajhoshi dadasiyat. Whatever charity you give away, do it as an offering to me. One should do philanthropy, but one should bring that Krishna element. One should do it that as a do it in Krishna consciousness. One can use philanthropy as a tool in order to give Krishna consciousness. And charity is one of the duties of a grahastha also. So, but making the mundane philanthropy as the goal, that will lead to frustration. So we see that Bharat Maharaj, because he became attached to the deer, he actually forgot his main mission of life for which he came to the forest. Whereas we have the example of Prithu Maharaj, when he saw that there are no food grains in the kingdom, and he saw what is the actually cause of the whole problem, and he saw the earth is not producing the food grains. After thinking deeply, he came to the conclusion, the earth is not producing the food grains, although the people were actually performing yajna, etc. And then the Prithu Maharaj became angry with Mother Earth, and then he went to attack Mother Earth. And Mother Earth took the form of a cow, thinking that will evoke sympathy from Prithu Maharaj. But Prithu Maharaj, although he saw the form of the cow, but Prithu Maharaj started chasing Mother Earth. So Prithu Maharaj did not get carried away by the external form of Mother Earth, in the form of a cow, and then he did not stop till Earth actually agreed to produce all the food grains. Prithu Maharaj says to Mother Earth, Puman Yoshid Utakleba Atma Sambhavano Dama Bhutesh Niranukroshu Nishpapam Tadavadvadu. Any cruel person, be he a man, a woman, or an important eunuch, who is only interested in his personal maintenance and has no compassion for other living entities, may be killed by the king. And such killing can never be considered actual killing. So in that way we find that Prithu Maharaj did not get carried away by the external form of the cow. But Bharat Maharaj got carried away by the form of the deer. And we see the example of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Mahaprabhu is called as Gadadhara Prananath, the life and soul of Gadadhara Pandit. But when Mahaprabhu was going to Vrindavan, Gadadhara Pandit, at a certain point, Mahaprabhu was repeatedly telling him not to come with him because he has taken the vow of Kshetra Sannyas. But Gadadhara Pandit, at a certain point, Mahaprabhu told him that after this land, you can't actually come with me. And Gadadhara Prabhu fell down and became unconscious. Although Mahaprabhu was Gadadhara Prananath, he is the life and soul of Gadadhara Pandit, and he had so much affection towards Gadadhara Pandit, but he did not even look back whether Gadadhara Pandit is alive or dead, and he just went ahead. And even Mahaprabhu, when he was going to South India Yatra, Sarvam Bhattacharya fell, he became unconscious, but Mahaprabhu did not turn back. So that is why Kaviraj Goswami says that sometimes great souls, they can be harder than a thunderbolt and they can be softer than a rose, and you can understand the mind of a great soul. But here Bharat Maharaj, he got carried away by the form of the deer. So another important point is that there is nothing wrong in Bharat Maharaj saving the deer, but later he became absorbed in taking care of the deer. So one has to understand one's capacity in trying to help others. So Bharat Maharaj didn't realize that it is not within his capacity to elevate the deer to a spiritual position. Therefore, he actually failed to understand that. So one of the functions of intelligence is that it's not only to discriminate and to solve the problems, but also to understand the limitations of our intelligence. Like what I can do or what I can't do. So Bharat Maharaj actually couldn't understand that. And when we talk about this principle of compassion, sometimes one can become so insensitive that although we see others suffering, and we become callous, and we don't do anything to help others. And another extreme is that we become absorbed in the material compassion and that we forget the higher goals of life. For example, there's another instance in the fourth canto, when the cruel king Vena died, when he was killed by the Brahmanas by the chanting of the mantras. At that time, the Brahmanas saw that in the absence of a king, the rogues and thieves were actually giving trouble to the common people. So the Brahmanas, they started considering the situation. Although previously they killed the king by chanting the mantras, but this time they had the power to actually kill the rogues and thieves, but they didn't do that. They didn't again take up the Kshatriya role to actually punish the rogues and thieves. But at the same time, the Brahmanas were thinking, Brahmana samadruk shanto dinanam samupekshakaha sravate brahma tasyapi binna bandat payoyata. The great sages began to think that although a Brahmana is peaceful and equal to everyone, but still it is not his duty to neglect the poor humans. By such neglect, a Brahmana's spiritual power diminishes. Just like water kept in a cracked pot, it gradually gets leaked out. Similarly, when you see that people are suffering, when you don't do anything to help them, then even though one may be chanting many rounds, but because you are not performing that the act of compassion, your whatever spiritual credit you earn by your sadhana, that will gradually get diminished. That's what Prabhupada says, that the Brahmanas are mostly devotees. They are generally unaware of the happenings within the material world because they are always busy with their spiritual advancement. But nonetheless, when there is a calamity in society, they cannot remain impartial. If they do not do something to relieve the distressed condition of human society, it is said that due to such neglect, their spiritual knowledge diminishes. So that is why one Vaishnava saint, Ramdas Swami, he mentions, a devotee should be spiritually absorbed, politically alert, and socially sensitive. So these Brahmanas, this time they did not actually take up the role of the king to punish the rogues and thieves. At the same time, they did not simply not do anything. So they churned the body of King Vena, and then Prithu Maharaj was born, and then they appointed Prithu Maharaj as the king, and then he took care of the wrong elements of the society. So therefore, but here Bharat Maharaj got absorbed in taking care of the deer. And I think Bhaktivinoda Thakur mentions about the Vaishnava compassion. He says that when can actually the real Jivadaya actually manifest? When we are free from Mayavad, atheism, devata worship, pretending to be a devotee, and Vaishnava aparad, then we can truly enter in the spirit of Jivadaya. Because these five things, they actually make the heart hard. And when we overcome these things, then the Jivadaya manifests. So, Bharat Maharaj's compassion towards deer is an example of a misplaced affection. When a person becomes overly attached to anything or the person of this world, forgetting the superior goal of life, that is an example of a misplaced affection. And once Bharat Maharaj, he couldn't see the deer, and he came out of the ashram and he saw the footprints of the deer. And he started saying that, the earth has become so fortunate because of being decorated with these footprints of a deer. And this place has become a fit place for performing sacrifice because of the footprints of the deer. But according to Mother Earth, in the first canto, in the conversation with Dharma, Mother Earth says that actually I was decorated with the footprints of Lord Krishna, and when I felt myself to be so fortunate, and suddenly Krishna wound up his pastimes and went back to the spiritual world, so I am feeling great separation from Krishna. So from the point of view of Mother Earth, she is feeling her real fortune was being decorated with the footprints of Krishna. When Krishna disappeared from the Ras Leela arena, the gopis were actually inquiring from the trees and plants and creepers, and they were inquiring from the earth. Can you please tell that what austerities you performed that you are decorated with the footprints of Krishna? We also want to perform such austerities. And we also want to get the association of Krishna. Wherever Krishna is, the Krishna is in, you are in constant association with Krishna. So that is how the gopis were actually perceiving when they saw the footprints of Krishna. But Bharat Maharaj, he actually, his affection was misplaced towards the deer. And one is misplaced affection, another is actually, or we can say unplaced affection. That means a person becomes so frustrated that he doesn't want to actually put affection on anybody. Vitaraga baya krodha manmayama upashrita bhagavo jnana tapasa puta madbhava magata. So Krishna says that when a person, sometimes a person is so frustrated and he is fearful of a personal identity in the spiritual world. He only wants to merge into the impersonal Brahman. So when a person overcomes, goes beyond this raga, bhaya and krodha, attachment towards the material objects and fear of a personal spiritual identity and anger arising from frustration of hearing different philosophies, when a person goes beyond all these three stages, then a person comes to the stage of actually surrendering to me. So sometimes a person becomes frustrated, he doesn't want to put affection on anybody. And then the third is the rightly placed affection. With Bhishma Dev says that, iti mati upakalpita vitrishna bhagavati sattvata pungave vibhumni. He says that, let me now invest my thinking, feeling and willing in the Supreme Personality of God. So long actually my thinking, feeling and willing have been engaged in so many different subjects, because Bhishma Dev was describing so many different dharmas to Yudhishthira Maharaj. But now at this point I want to invest all my thinking, feeling and willing on the Supreme Personality of God. So that is an example of rightly placed affection. And another point from Bharat Maharaj is that, Prabhupada explained that mistake in Bharat Maharaj is that Bharat Maharaj did not consult any devotees, did not consult a spiritual master when he became attached to the deer. Whereas we see Vyasadeva, even after writing so many Vedic literatures, when he felt dissatisfied, when he was in a state of depression or dissatisfaction, that time he consulted his guru Narada Muni in order to find out the root cause of his dissatisfaction. And Lord Chaitanya, when he was actually going through the spiritual ecstasies after chanting the holy names, he consulted his guru Ishwarapuri to find out what is happening to him. So both in two extremes, the incarnations of the Lord are actually demonstrating that whether in depression or in ecstasy, one should never think oneself to be independent of the Supreme Lord, independent of the spiritual master. But here, Bharat Maharaj, he did not consult a spiritual master, therefore he fell from his position. And therefore, that lesson became so deep in his heart, therefore as a Jadabharat, he tells his instruction to Rahugan, Rahu gunaita tapasana yati, na chejaya nirvapanad grahadva, na chandasa naiva jalagni surya, vina mahatpada rajobhishekam. He says that one cannot attain the Supreme Lord by performing intense austerities and by surrounding oneself with the fire, or by the performance of intense vows of sannyas, or by the performance of different yajna. The only way is actually by serving the lotus feet of a pure devotee, vina mahatpada rajobhishekam. Because this lesson was so deeply etched in his heart, therefore he mentions that to Rahugan Maharaj. Lastly, I will conclude with this point that Radhanath Maharaj mentioned in a class that the purpose of association with a devotee is that to become fixed in the goal of life and to become fixed in the sadhana for attaining the goal of life. In the case of Dhruva Maharaj, that when he got the association of Narada Muni, at that time, his goal of life was to get a kingdom greater than that of Lord Brahma. But by the association of Narada Muni, initially he became fixed in the sadhana to please the Lord. That means Narada Muni engaged him in devotional service. But his goal remained the same. That is to attain a kingdom greater than that of Lord Brahma. But gradually by performing that sadhana, then he became so purified that his goal changed from getting a kingdom greater than that of Lord Brahma to actually devotional service to Krishna. Swamin Kritartosmi Varamna Yachi. But in the case of Bharat Maharaj, he was fixed in the sadhana to please Krishna and he was fixed in the goal of life. But in the absence of the association of the devotees in the forest, he actually got diverted from the goal of life and he also got diverted from the sadhana to attain that goal of life. And therefore, there are many other points, but since it's time, I'll end here. So we learned so many different lessons from Bharat Maharaj's character. So therefore, this Bharat Maharaj's personality is so exalted. He actually he fits the perfect description of the Paramahamsa described by Lord Krishna in these verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we discussed about how one kind of Paramahamsa, he acts within the Varnashram system. But another kind of Paramahamsa, he acts outside the Varnashram system. So in that regard, we discuss the story of Bharat Maharaj, Jada Bharat. Few points I just try to share. So anybody would like to ask any comment or any question? No? Just a few minutes will take otherwise.
Hare Krishna, thank you for your discourse. But one thing I would like to know in this your lecture, Vaishnava Aparadha is the biggest thing that what Saubhari Rishi Muni is did. And because of that, he fall down. So we being in association with devotees, many times it happens. So how can we, you know, take care so that no Vaishnava Aparadha could be happened from us? Because that is the most dangerous thing which I understood from your lecture.
Yeah, one need not be paranoid of Vaishnava Aparadha. One has to be aware of the Vaishnava Aparadha. Aparadha is basically is an activity which is intended to displease a devotee, which is intended to bring down a devotee. So, and one of the reasons why a person commits Aparadha is that a person considers something exalted, devotee or a vastu, something which is exalted to be material. So therefore we perform some aparadha. Therefore, in order to understand the true position of the devotee or the different aspects of bhakti, so one has to hear regularly. By hearing regularly, then we understand the things in the true perspective. And that helps us to maintain the mood of reverence and not take it cheaply. What I would say. So I'll stop here. Just we have one announcement. There is a one-day seminar on the overview of Bhagavad Gita, chapter 3 and 4, in Hindi, by His Grace Baldev Prabhu. And next Sunday, you can see the notice board for registration details. And there is also a course on learning basic spoken Sanskrit, Sanskrit Sambhashana. This is a 10-session course, 10-day course. This will be from 15th to 27th May with some few dates in between are not there. And this will be conducted by Arun Hariharan Prabhu. And we can again see the notice board for actually registering. So I'll stop here. Granthana Srimad Bhagavatam ki jaya. Gaurabhaktavandaki.